As I was preparing this week, I tried to think about an image of something or someone that would be considered powerful. Something that I could just relate to and say, yeah, that's power. And the image sometimes can look at and we can say it's a political image of a politician. It could be a king, it could be a president, it could be a pope, or it could be maybe nature, the power of nature. Regardless of what that is, we have a tendency as human beings to try to appease this power. We want to please, we want to be on the right side of this power that has control over things in our lives. So we try to appease. And sometimes we get to the point where we're worshiping this particular type of power. And we have to look at ourselves and say, what type of power are we worshiping? Where do we spend most of our time worrying about doing, trying to please? And we have to relate it to the King of Kings. We call Jesus King of Kings. It's so inadequate to refer to Jesus as King of Kings, but that's the best we can come up with. I mean, how does that compare to how we behave, how we let things motivate us compared to what Jesus is asking us to do? See, Pilate had that problem, and so did the Hebrews at the time. He had that problem looking at this Jesus, and he looked at him. Here he was arrested the night before. He was in jail. He didn't come there in robes and garments that would indicate a king. He came there all disheveled. He looked terrible. He's standing before Pilate, and Pilate says in a condescending way, "You are the king of the Jews?" You know, and he's relating it to himself. Look at me, how I'm dressed. I'm clean. You're unkempt. You look terrible. And you're supposed to be the king. And he's saying it in a way that I should be threatened by you. I was worried about you. You're nothing to me. And that's what he wants. That's what he's saying to Jesus. You are zero to me. But Jesus plays a game with him a little bit. When Pilate says, "So are you king of the Jews?" What did Jesus say? "Are you saying this on your own?" He was slapping Pilate down. He was saying to Pilate, "Oh, you're acknowledging that I'm a king? Are you saying that on your own? Do you see that I'm a king?" And Pilate gets upset with that. "What, am I a Jew?" And he's going back and forth. He's arguing on a political environment, and Jesus is trying to elevate it to a theological level. You see, sometimes we get so caught up in the politics of things. We get so caught up in things that would make us feel good. We get so caught up in our ego. We want to appease these powers that give us creature comforts, that make us feel more pleased with ourselves, that pat us on the back. And we conjure up an image of something that relates to our own personality, things that we agree with. And then we're creating an idol. We're creating an idol. Because Jesus never considered himself a king. In Mark 10, a couple of weeks ago, we were listening to Mark 10. And what was Jesus saying? Jesus says, if you want to follow me, if you want to be Christ-like, you must move with compassion. Compassion for whom? For those that are in need. Because I have equipped you with gifts and talents to bless and serve others. Feed the hungry, shelter the homeless, visit the sick, visit those in prison, heal those who need healing. They need your touch, and I equipped you. And we're all equipped in one way or another to be Christ-like to someone. Or we can just hoard it. Or we can live in that fear of powers and authorities outside of Christ. We gotta get on the good side of this one. We gotta vote this way. We gotta, you get on Facebook and see all kinds of weird things going on, right? But Jesus never considered himself a king. He came, he tells us in Matthew 25, he came to serve, not to be served. And earlier in John, we read, "I have come not to condemn you." Listen to that. Not to condemn you, but to save you, should you want it. We can just stay in our own pathetic reasoning and just listen to other voices, or we can listen to the voice of Christ and apply it in our lives. You see, the world is looking at you and me. You may be the only Bible someone reads. They say, that person is a Christian. That person that just did that unkind thing, whatever that is. That person whose children bully kids in school. You know, those are the Christians? I want to be like that. I want to be like that. So the question to you and me is, who are you? What are you? As Pilate says to Jesus, are you a king? He says to you and me today, are you a Christian? Are you a Christian? And that's a real compelling thing for us to kind of think about. Our behavior. Our behavior. There's a song written by Bob Dylan many years ago. I'm going to show you my age. Okay. Bob Dylan, and he says, you got to serve somebody. It could be the devil, or it could be the Lord, but you got to serve somebody. A year later, John Lennon wrote a song, and it said, serve yourself. And there's the two, there's the tension right there. Serve yourself, don't worry about anything else or anybody, and that's serving Satan or whatever, it's the spirits of evil, whatever you want to look at that. But serving God, serving the Lord, decision we have to make. And what does Jesus say to us? And the scriptures constantly say, if you'll come to me with a sincere heart and repent of your ways, I will forgive you. You understand that? We're going to say the Lord's Prayer later. And in a little time, we're going to say the Lord's Prayer. And we're going to say that one thing. And when you say it, remember that God's listening to it. Because this frightens me sometimes saying it. Forgive me my sins as I forgive those who sin against me. I can see when we say, Lord, forgive me my sins. I can see His grace and mercy coming down from the clouds to forgive me. And then I stop that hand. Because I think, as I forgive those who harm me. And I haven't forgiven certain people at certain times. But you know, there are times you just say, well, I can't forgive this or that. Well, then you pray for a desire to forgive. God can work with that. We hear in Daniel, once again, the Hebrews are being persecuted. But in Daniel, it's very clear. The message in Daniel is this. God has the final say with your destiny, and He will be faithful to save you, should you want it. And in Revelation, we hear the same old thing. Well, there's so many things. People look at Revelations, and they're comparing it to Nostradamus. They're comparing it to all these other prophets. The thing about the Revelations is this. The truth is not in the details. It's not in the details. The truth of Revelation is in the fact that God has the victory and we have the victory through Christ. That's the whole message that John's trying to get across. And he's using all kinds of symbols because he's writing to a persecuted church at a certain time in history. And then we try to apply, in this 2015, Jesus, look. No. Don't get distracted with the details. It's very clear. Christ has a salvation message for you. And that is the truth that he says, anyone who seeks me will be seeking the truth, and that truth will set you free. That truth, not a politician, not a boss, not a social circle, not education. The truth, that's where we need to be, truth seekers, and that alone will set you